set. Okay, I think we'll call this public hearing to order. This is a public hearing of the Senate Standing Committee on Elections. I am not Senator Addabbo, the chair of the committee. He is on his way. His flight has landed, and he'll be here momentarily. But we have a number of speakers who wish to present testimony today, so we're going to begin. And while I'm not on the committee, I'm the host senator here, so I'm delighted to welcome first my colleagues to my left, Senator Antoine Thompson, who's joining us from Buffalo, Senator Joe Griffo, who's joining us from Utica today. When the chairman gets here, I'm sure he'll have some opening comments of his own, but I'll just very briefly, for those who are here, and for the record, share with you that this is one in a series of five public hearings that are taking place around the state involving the issue of reform of our election laws. Albany, Syracuse earlier, and later in June, September, and November around the state. Our task is to consider various pieces of legislation and hear testimony on pieces of legislation regarding reform of the election process and reinvigorating participatory democracy. And I appreciate, again, my colleagues who are here. I'll note also for the record that Senator Griffo is the former chairman of the Election Law Committee in his first term in the Senate. So we're delighted to have him here, both in that role and as a member of the committee itself. Before we call our witnesses, and what we would do is just ask as we call them forth to come to the table in front of the dais, we'd ask that you try to keep your remarks, I guess, limited to around 5 to 10 minutes, and we'll have an opportunity for comments. We do have, I think, 15 or 16 individuals who have signed up to speak, so we'll try to keep things moving along as quickly as possible. And the camera here is an indication that we are webcasting this hearing, as we are doing with as many, if not all, public hearings. What is it? NYSenate.gov? Is that anybody know? NYSenate.gov. Okay. All right. Very good. Opening comments from Senator Thompson?
Yes. Let me just say, I think this is excellent. And I just want to commend you and the committee as well for having this public hearing. In addition to all the folks that have come out, I'm just really impressed by how many people have come out from this region. I think it's great because, you know, the goal here is to make voting easier, but also secure and protecting the vote. But so I'm really excited. I'm a big voting rights person, and so I'm really glad to be able to just drop in for a few minutes and say that this is an awesome turnout, and that hopefully you'll have some great dialogue and help make voting easier, but also more secure as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Thompson. Senator Griffo?
I want to thank everyone for being here today, and I'll share also the fact that it's so important to have many of you here to provide your input and to be involved in this process. As we have heard, this is so essential to our democracy, so while we want to make it easier to vote, we also want to make sure that we preserve the integrity of the voting system. So there are a number of pieces of legislation that are being considered, and your input will help us as we make that decision. And I also want to echo what Senator Valesky said. As you come up, I know that you'll be filing testimony. If you can summarize many of your statements, it gives us an opportunity to interact with you more, then I think that is something that's beneficial for all of us involved. So thank you for being here.
Thank you, Senator. First, we'll hear from Ed Ryan, the Elections Commissioner, Democratic Elections Commissioner here in Onondaga County. Ed? Please. Tom, if you want to collect and distribute. Whichever you prefer, Commissioner.
Obviously, what we do with the legislature money is a key issue. Obviously, based on these one-liners. So if I interpreted the resolution incorrectly, stop me, because we did it on one sentence and not reading the full bill. I'm not sure what the impact of the full bill is. So we'll go with early voting. We'll start with that one. This would create a need for additional personnel. Our staff is on overtime at this period between printing poll books, creating and test-decking, setting up the polling places, and fine-tuning 2,000 inspectors, many of whom, at the last minute, will tell us they can't work. With 65 different ballot codes this year, it must be handled with extreme care for somehow handing out a ballot code at the Board of Elections, knowing the right one to give these people. In my view, this is an unfunded mandate that we would be pressed into, that we will have to hire additional people with experience to do this, because this could get expensive, and we absolutely want to make sure that we have the right ballot code and the right vote hand, and that's a big concern to us. The no-excuse absentee. It takes approximately 5 minutes for our staff to process an absentee voter start to finish. By the time they call in, when we mail things out, we bring it back. We had 13,142 absentee ballots last year, and we sent out 15,653 ballots that had been sent out. Our cost per ballot was about $3.26 per voter. To process a regular absentee voter in the presidential year, we now have spent over $3 million to accommodate all voters with a new voting system, and now you are going to another direction will incur additional costs on our part. As a county representative, it's another expense I've got to go to our legislature and ask them to bear this on the tax, on the property tax. This could be a problem. Now, Oregon has absentee ballots. You know, if we went all that way, well, then that would make sense. Just send a ballot out to every voter, you know, and mail it back. That probably would be the easiest. But when we have two and three and four different ways to vote here, mistakes get made, ballots get handed out the wrong way, and the personnel that we have running it gets very hairy trying to get all this done when you got four different directions to vote. The next one is the affidavit ballot. If a voter is allowed to vote at any poll site, they would be well be voting for candidates who would not be representing them. If I read this correctly, then you're asking that, and this is the one I'm very unsure of. The way I read it is, if you want to go to a polling site in your county, that you can just go to that polling site and vote, whether it's your particular voting district or not. And I may have misinterpreted that, but that's the way I interpreted it. If that's the case, you know, we tried pilot plan A. Some of these areas don't have enough room because we have to have tables, both private polling or voting booths. So we're trying to accommodate everybody where the spaces are available. And I think all of you are aware that getting accessible polling places for 16 hours in particular day in particular areas are difficult, especially in the city where a lot of the older places are not handicapped accessible. But we've been doing that, and we've eliminated the ones that are not handicapped accessible. Split shift. This very well could work, but we run the risk of not having enough inspectors. Right now, we train about 2,500 inspectors, and we hope to have 1,800 to 2,000 at the end of the day after some of them go through the process and quit before they get there. We could also have a problem with the state. We had a group coming in at 6 a.m. and leaving at 2, and then another group coming at 2 to 9. What do we do if the group coming in the afternoon chooses not to come in? Then we're forcing that person who was expecting to be there half a day to stay. That's something that has to be thought through, so it's a workable situation.
We'll just pause for just a moment. Thank you, Commissioner. Chairman Addabbo. Addabbo, Kings County, Chairman. I think we're okay, right? Please, yes.
All right, so, I mean, the idea of a split shift, it could possibly work, but there's got to be some caveats out there because we have trouble right now in certain areas getting enough Democratic inspectors, in certain areas getting Republican inspectors, and unless we get younger people in here and more people involved in it, then this isn't going to work. And we struggle every year to get quality inspectors,
especially when we go to the new machine and you're talking about affidavits handing out the right ballot code. We have 65 ballot codes this year, and if you have inept inspectors and they're handing out wrong ballot codes to people, we're in for a lot of problems. So getting 2,000 qualified people to be inspectors and now going to 4,000 is a yeoman's task in order for that to be done and done properly. There is the voting in the proper place. You've asked here on 2443 that the poll worker could instruct people to go to the right polling place. We have 204 polling places. We have 459 polling districts. And we have people that you're asking to tell them where their polling place is in another town or even on the other side of the county. It would be absolutely impossible for us to arm the 2,000 polling inspectors with all the maps and polling districts to tell these people exactly where they're going to go. People get confused when you have polling places that are split by the middle of the street, much less five or six towns away. There is a software system out there for it. It's called AskEd. And it does work. It would cost us $45,000 to purchase, and obviously there's updates on that because it's a software system, and I'm not sure we have the ability to get that through our county legislature to get enough of these handheld devices to tell them how to get there. But it's $45,000 first year and then all the upgrades on it. So. Again, like everything else in town, it comes down to money. We'd like to do it all, but yet how much do we do it? The form of a paper ballot, absolutely agree. If there's anything on any of these things you should do, this is the absolute first one you should do. Having someone go into a polling booth and bullet vote for somebody or vote for half the people because they don't know the people down the end and have to have that paper come back to them because the machine is spitting it back because they've undervoted. If they check this box, it goes through. It will save a lot of frustration. So we agree that should go. And if you have any other questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
First, Commissioner Ryan, I want to thank you very much for being here and, again, participating in these hearings that we've taken throughout the state. And certainly we are mindful that the Elections Committee, as it turns out, that this legislation does have an impact on Board of Elections throughout the state. And we want to be mindful of that because, obviously, we need to work together as we implement these pieces of legislation. One thing we don't want to do is do legislation that's going to put an undue burden on the workers at the Board of Elections, which, again, I've said it at all these public hearings, the Board of Election workers work throughout the year, not just on election year or just on election day. They work throughout the year, and I appreciate the workers that you have at the Board of Elections. So we have to be mindful that, you know, we want to work with the Board of Elections to make sure that when we do pieces of legislation that they're not unfunded mandates, that they work very well with the Board of Elections. And so we hope to increase the amount of communication with the Board of Elections throughout the state. So, again, I appreciate your input here. Certainly this opens the door. Obviously, the communications don't have to be just at a public hearing. They should be whenever you feel that the Elections Committee should take up an item, should take up an issue, address an issue, or currently is addressing an issue that is of concern to you. So I please welcome your input as well. Do any of my colleagues have questions? Yep. Senator Griffo.
Hey, Commissioner, how are you?
I'm wonderful. How are you?
Good. Former county official, I totally understand some of the concerns that you've expressed, and I think actually that you all have to play an important role in any of the legislation that is developed and as it evolves because your input is very valuable, and it's important to understand the impact it would have on the actual operations and cost associated with the conduct of elections. The last thing you talked about with the undervote, I want to make sure I just understood. You said you thought that should be a priority. In the last hearing, some people expressed some concerns about additional lines and singling out people who may have not voted, because then they would have known that some of these people may have voted intentionally for a particular race, may have purposely not voted. So you're not indicating that we should force them to vote on every race, are you, if their choice is not to?
Oh, absolutely not. There's probably 30% of the people don't vote the whole ballot, you know, because they don't know names, and then, you know, they're there for a few. This, if I'm understanding the resolution correctly,
right,
is if you want to vote for three people out of 10, you know, that are 10 races, you check and say, I understand I've undervoted on this ballot, but that is, in fact, all the people I want to vote for, so the machine will accept it rather than send it back to them, and then they got to push more buttons to say, I understand it, and send it through. We're talking about a lot of people who are not computer savvy that are going to be frustrated when that comes back to them. And now they're going to feel, okay, now that somebody's watching me, I got to go back and vote for these people, even though I don't want to. This is a training exercise for a lot of people that is going to be difficult for some of the seniors to get involved with once they hit that machine and it keeps spitting it back to them because they didn't do something right. The other, you know, just as an aside, you know, we're all running out this pilot program and we're all trying to get this done right. And I think this is one thing that I think is scaring the hell out of a lot of us here is, and I just talked to the voter for verification over here, is if you go to 100% man counting, and I wanted to just leave these numbers with you. We're going to try to do three towns that have a single ballot code because that would be easy just in case we're forced to do a hand count. We have 65 ballot codes in Onondaga County this year. So that's 65 different ballots that we've got to make sure get in the right hands of the right people. We had our two deputies take a look at 2 years ago. They pulled out 100 absentee ballots and hand counted them. And I want to leave you these numbers because this is money. This is money. If you and I were run against each other, it would take about 3 minutes to count the 100 ballots. If it was two out of the four of us, it would take 15 minutes. If it was three out of six of us, it took 45 minutes. You know, if it was 4 out of 8, it took 1 hour and 20 minutes to make sure every vote was counted in the right place, and they actually had 100 votes between them. So on that particular ballot, which was, unusual because we had best out of 2, best out of 3, best out of 4, took 2 hours and 20 minutes to count 100 ballots, and that's 2 people. Now, last election, where there was twice as many ballots, but they were all single, that would be a lot simpler. So the idea of it and the practicality of it, how it works, you have to understand. So if we got 2 hours and 20 minutes by 2 people, and we have 110,000 ballots, that's a lot of time and a lot of dollars on the backs here. So there's got to be a better way to double check this. You've got to put some, and they spoke about it too, it's got to be a close race. It's got to be something because, again, we are blessed here in Onondaga County because our legislature has been more than adequate of funding what we needed to do what we need to do. Some of the smaller counties that you'll hear from, they're struggling to keep up right now without anything else. So I don't speak about us so much as some of our neighboring counties are going to have a very, very difficult time funding some of these things because they don't have the resources to do what they're supposed to do now.
Commissioner Ryan, one last quick question. Briefly, can you state how much the Onondaga County Board of Elections budget is currently and how that fares to last year's budget, up or down?
Well, we're up a couple $100,000, and we put that in there because if we went to complete Plan A, and our budget's about $3.3 million, if we went Plan A, which means we would have to, under the new rules, make 330,000 ballots because we have about 287,000 voters, and you're supposed to make 110% ballots. Even we know in an off election year, you're only going to have 35% of the people voting. So we are predicated. We're looking to see how do we get a local printer or some printer that can make them as we need them. Because last year, well, we put in a couple $100,000 for, to answer your question, that we may not use. But if they make us use Plan A, then we have to go out and print these ballots at a cost of about $200,000. And that's... we're not expecting to use it, but if the judge tells us we have to use it, it's there. So okay. That's in there.
One question. Commissioner, just one question. In regard to the first bill that's been proposed and for which we're seeking comment in regard to early voting, and I imagine a number of our speakers to come as the day continues will address the issue, particularly perhaps Professor Reher and Professor Spitzer can talk about national trends. My understanding is 32 other states now have gone to a system of early voting for all sorts of reasons. I hear your concern in regard to the fiscal issue, and I sympathize with those concerns. But leaving those concerns aside, from the perspective of the Board of Elections, do you have any opinion in regard to a movement toward early voting as many other states have done? Again, leaving aside the fiscal concerns that you obviously have.
Well, allowing people to vote, obviously, is what we need to do. We need to get, think about it. You go to some other countries, they stand in line for an hour and a half, they walk 2 hours. People, we're America is I want it, and I want it now, and I don't want to wait 5 minutes for it, And anything can be done as long as you can afford to do it. And there is the problem. We would have to hire couple of people that are honed in and know when I give you this ballot, it's the right one. I just didn't grab it and give you a ballot and you're voting for somebody that's not going to represent you. And you're going to get your busy times and slow times, and I don't know what time period you got, but last year we were working for 3.5 weeks, 12 hours a day, Monday through Friday, and 10 hours on Saturday, and we didn't have early voting. Now we have early voting. That could bring in another 5,000 or 6,000 people that we have to take care of in a timely fashion and space to do it in. So all those things, we're running around like chickens, trying to get this done. Can it be done? Yeah, anything can be done, but we'll need the bodies to do it.
Commissioner, again, thank you very much for your time and testimony today. I look forward to a continuing conversation with you on these bills.
Good.
So thank you very much, Commissioner. Our Our next individual to give testimony, Edward Sesniak, former Elections Commissioner for Onondaga County Board of Elections. While Mr. Sesniak is coming here, let me first formally say thank you for being here. And it's a pleasure being here in Syracuse. What this committee is doing is going throughout the state, having these public hearings on issues that are coming through the Elections Committee and ideas that we go to hope to work in the future on. So again, it is a pleasure being here. Let me just do a little housekeeping. I want to thank all staff who has helped put this together, everyone for being here and working on this. It's a pleasure being in Senator Dave Valesky's district. So again, Senator Valesky, thank you very much, and your staff as well. Senator Griffo, good to see you again, and thank you for being here as well. I want to thank Bayer Muhammad, who helped also put this together, and again, I'd like to thank him. To my far right, David Kolgeman is the legal counsel for the Elections Committee. And again, I want to thank David for his help on this hearing, as well as Bernadette Oliver from my office for putting this together. In short, ladies and gentlemen, you know, whether we talk about, you know, voters in my district, which is Southwest, Queens, and New York City, or whether we talk about voters here in Syracuse, the concerns are the same. It is one New York, and we are looking to basically look at the process of voting from registration all the way up into the actual voting process, trying to make it easier and more facilitate the process for all qualified voters. So that is the idea that we have here. We are dealing with that in terms of legislation and administrative decisions that have to be made. And so, therefore, your input is rather important. So, again, I appreciate your time and participation here today, this hearing. I'm going to ask now from here on future speakers to try and keep their comments to roughly 3 minutes, if we could. We don't have a buzzer or any type of electric shock treatment going on here to stop people from talking for 3 minutes. But in order to give the list, and we have a pretty extensive list of speakers, to give everybody opportunity to speak and time for questions and answers, I'm going to ask, even if you have written testimony, if you can briefly summarize it to an extent and keep your comments to roughly about 3 minutes so that we can get through the whole list while our time is here. So, again, former Commissioner Sesniak, a pleasure, and thank you for your testimony.
Senators, Mr. Chairman, I don't want to call you Senator.
Right.
I want to thank you all for the opportunity to share my thoughts on some of this proposed election law reform. And I'm following Eddie. I'm Election Commissioner Light, I guess you could say, at this point in time. What I'd like to do, then I'll try to briefly touch on the various acts as was presented with a few thoughts of mine on each of them, the first one being the Early Voting Act. To me, the fact that early voting would make participation earlier easier for citizens who cannot make it to the polls on Election Day is obviously a positive thing. However, I believe this is better addressed by allowing these voters to use the absentee ballot process without the current restrictions on accessibility the absentee ballots, as is addressed by another of the resolutions. Election day breakdowns are adequately addressed, I believe, with the affidavit ballots. We're in the four-year cycle, and even, however, in the years of presidential elections, when we may get 78% turnout here in Onondaga County, very seldom are there significant waiting times to vote. The issue of a person in one centralized location also would not be a convenient piece of countywide voters. Registration and voting data would have to be made available at the centralized site, and that's why you almost need the centralized site. But also be aware that many village and other elections are not currently conducted by the County Board of Elections. So to have an outlying town asking those folks who happen to be having, say, a primary election to come out and vote at the centralized here in the center of Syracuse is truly not a convenient opportunity for these folks. And then, of course, there would be a need to have a tracking system created so that people don't vote early and then, of course, again, at their regular polling place. I guess what I'm really saying about that particular bill is I think there's a better way to bite the apple. And also there's more fiscal implications than just printing more absentee ballots. I just stress that. In terms of Senate Bill 5028, the absentee voting constitutional amendment, that is something that election commissioners across the state have been lobbying for upteen years. And so I think that would be a major asset. Of course, it's the difficult hurdle of changing the Constitution that presents its real problem. in terms of Senate Bill 2868, absentee voting election law amendment, that's just changing election law. I agree with 100% with the justification that was presented with the bill. In terms of Senate Bill 1701, counting of affidavit ballots, this I have a difficulty agreeing with. Administrative error on the part of inspectors, I agree, should not be a basis not to count a vote. On the other hand, federal as well as New York State case law is dictating otherwise, saying that a voter must be in the correct polling place to be able to count that affidavit ballot. The other considerations really are inspectors could be required to determine if the voter is in the current correct polling place. But as Eddie already testified, once you get beyond their own location and you start expanding as to where a voter should vote throughout the county, very, very difficult thing to do. And probably the most critical piece and why I suspect that the courts have ruled that you have to be in a correct polling place is that that's the ballot you have. The other polling place, you're going to have different versions of the ballot. And if somebody, even within here, say the city of Syracuse, comes in and they're on the east side of the city in a particular county legislative district and they're in the wrong place, but even though they're currently an active voter, registered voter, their county legislator is a total different contest and they're not going to have that ballot in that location as well. So they may vote on that ballot, sometimes forgetting who the candidates are for their real ballot, and think they've walked away voting in a properly a proper vote, and they really haven't voted for anybody. Requirement for Senate Bill 1058, requirement for all polling places to be accessible to physically disabled voters. Obviously, federal law requires that, mandates that. To me, the issue truly is understanding what accessible means. Boards of elections are not experts in evaluating accessibility standards. These may be better evaluated by building code enforcement officers who deal with that type of activity on a regular basis. Also, boards of elections use polling places normally only two or three times a year. Many of these are government and school facilities that are federally mandated to meet these same accessibility standards year-round, but don't. They usually use, as in some educational locations, they use their own equivalent of a waiver by saying that, oh, we have all our disabled students go to just one of our 10 school locations, therefore we make sure that one is accessibility is there, but the other ones don't have it. Yet when it comes to voting, everybody has to have it. So it would seem more appropriate just to enforce the standards across the board for all the public facilities that we normally use as polling places, but are there all year round. Finally, the commitment of time for training, conducting site evaluations, ensuring adjustments are made to ensure accessibility, purchasing and distributing the temporary items such as ramps, and then documenting all these changes with all these surveys, et cetera, and paying for many of these adjustments far exceed what's in the bill, limited local fiscal implications. So there are some real dollars involved in doing that type of accessibility. Senate Bill 5112, voting in the proper polling place. Again, the concept is fine. However, requiring poll inspectors to be prepared to consult a map, street finder, et cetera, for all election districts, for all polling places in the county is a major challenge. Remember, poll inspectors work one or two days a year in this role. Their pay is more geared toward being a volunteer than an election law and countywide geography expert. Polling places change every year. A lot of misinformation can be given by ill-informed part-time inspectors. Now, I know we have all good inspectors, and some are even a little better than others, but they are part-time, and they're not necessarily compensated to a degree that would warrant them becoming the experts that we'd like them to be. It's better to have the voter call the Board of Elections, as we do now, by giving them this white little card that we've been doing for years. They call the board and we tell them the proper place to go to. And overall, that's been a pretty good system. Sometimes we get backed up with those type of calls because we only got 30, 40 lines on any particular election day to be able to respond to those type of calls. but at least they're getting the correct information. They go to the right polling place. They will have the correct ballot for them to be able to complete. The last item was Bill 5112, and that goes to the form of paper ballots. And there it's an interpretation of what was meant by somebody checking off either at the beginning of the ballot to say, hey, I know I'm going to undervote, or if it was, I don't know where it was going. But if it was just an added requirement, and they were still going to have the machine kick out each time they undervoted, to me is just a superfluous and probably a time-consuming thing that didn't need to be. I think that's the less specific thing that I had. The one thing I would just make as a general observation, a lot of what we talk about in this type of bills has to do with people. And there's no system that's a perfect system, no matter when we're looking at various voting systems or as we're dealing with these various issues we're talking about this morning. It's the people, in this case, the representatives of the boards of elections, are those inspectors out for all those different polling places. And too many times we think in terms just as an extension of staff, and so they're very qualified, very well trained, and everything else. And in reality, it is two or three times a year they're just doing this. And as much as they want to do it well, remembering from year to year, even what the updated law changes have been, become a challenge for them as well. So those are things that I guess maybe one last thing I would say, and this came up when I was with the Election Assistance Commission group at the federal level, that some of this seems to go to another trend that I've heard about in different states where they're doing super election districts, really trying to combine wider geographic areas into one location. That just seems to go against or is contrary to what has been the thrust here in New York State to make elections convenient as much as possible to the voters. And in the upstate counties in particular, the time distances can be substantial as opposed to New York City, where you may have congressional districts in five blocks or something like that. And so it's just a different world in terms of time distance. So convenience is a relative factor. And I would end my specific comments that way, unless there's some questions.
Commissioner Sesniak, thank you very much. One quick question I have, and if you could answer briefly, I would appreciate it. Earlier on, you mentioned early voting, and then you spoke about absentee ballots. There's a piece of legislation proposed that says we would like to remove the default or the reasoning for absentee ballots, thus creating a situation where more absentee ballots may be available to voters. Do you have any objection to that if you say that you'd rather see absentee ballots instead of early voting?
Yeah, that's what I mentioned early on. I felt the justification was there. I'm supportive of that. They have limited inhibitions, if you will, on why people should be able to use an absentee. And I know there's some of the election law stuff that you're correcting in some of this, but some of it goes to the state constitution, and that's just a bigger challenge to get to, but I think we ought to take the challenge and just make it more more accessible.
Thank you very much. Any questions?
One quick question.
Sure.
Ed, thank you for your testimony. One bill that has been introduced as part of this packet, and I'm not sure if you addressed it or not, Senator Klein has introduced a bill that would allow local boards of elections to utilize elections inspectors for half-day shifts. I imagine in your many years of experience, you would say that it's been getting more and more difficult to have election inspectors. Would half-day shifts help the situation? Would it make it even more difficult in effect, perhaps have to double the number of the number of inspectors necessary?
My thoughts on that go to the following. I think there are times when it's been very beneficial to have the law allow us to have half-day shifts. I think we would still prefer to try to get people that are willing to be there the whole day, but whether it's just a challenge of getting adequate numbers of folks or whatever the reason, to have half-day shifts could be a doable project. I think the issue there, and Eddie tried to address a little bit, is there are some consequences when you're going to change, especially if you did everybody. If everybody worked from 6 a.m. to say 1 o'clock, and then the second shift came in, you lacked a continuity of what happened at the beginning of the day versus the end of the day. And part of what we're doing normally with the inspectors is saying, we want you to check those machines, make sure everything was zeroed out, everything was correct. And so anything that happens during the day, you're going to have been there and seen. At the end of the day, you're going to verify that those are the numbers that voted, et cetera. When you break at midday, you're going to have different folks. They don't know what happened early in the morning. And whether that's going to be a critical element or not, I think it could be at some particular times. Particularly as we go to a lot of even the absentees, et cetera, another issue. But as we get to close elections, all of a sudden everybody wants to dot the I's and cross the T's. That becomes much more critical to having had somebody there all day long to have watched the whole process and with credibility say, nothing went wrong over here. I know the problems we had on the machines. That's why we had so many affidavit ballots. And there shouldn't be any more, shouldn't be any less.
Commissioner, thank you very much. Again, thank you for your time and testimony.
Thank you.
Our next, we're going to start calling up individuals in teams of two. They could be unrelated to their testimony, but again, it's just a two-person panel. So the next two are Preston Fagan, president of the NAACP of Syracuse, and Frank Panisi, South Tier Independent Center.
I want to say thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Preston Fagan. I am the president of the Syracuse Onondaga County NAACP. On behalf of our officers, executive committee, membership, constituents, and colleagues, I want to thank the committee for the opportunity to address one of the important issues that are of the utmost concern in election reform. I'm going to speak regarding Senate Bill 2443. As you may know, in Syracuse election districts and undoubtedly in other districts across the state, there is an ongoing problem of potential voters arriving to vote at the wrong polling place and finding that they are not registered in the polling book. This is a common problem and one that is traditionally treated in different ways at different districts. For example, if a potential voter is unknown in the district but appears to belong, she or he will usually be accorded the full courtesy and respect of election inspectors. On the other hand, if that individual appears different in any way, she or he is likely to be treated less courteously and in some cases without outright disrespect, often causing the individual to leave the polling place in frustration or anger and give up going to the polls at all. The solution to this is simple, although not necessarily easy from a physical point of view. To begin with, election inspectors should be trained to treat everyone with respect, and every polling place should be spot checked at spontaneous intervals by the Board of Election Observers to be sure that board policy is carried out. Secondly, a computer with appropriate software listing every polling place in the county should be placed at every polling site so that potential voters can be told not only where their polling site is, but can also be given a map printout that shows where they are now with clear-cut directions to the correct site where they need to go. In this way, election inspectors can perform a positive service for potential voters and may even encourage them to actually go the extra mile to the correct polling place and vote. Perhaps the state could fund this initiative by using stimulus monies to provide the computers, software, and training. The state could also develop a prototype to track voter participation in a longitudinal study conducted over a short term or midterm to determine the success of this extra effort by election officials to increase voter participation. The simplicity of this strategy is that only one computer needs to be available at each site. Even if more than one district is housed at the facility, since voters can be assisted on a first-come, first-served basis. And the actual assistance given should take minimum of time and effort if inspectors are properly trained in the use of the software. That is the end of my testimony for today, and I thank you for allowing me.
Thank you, Mr. Fagan. Thank you. Mr. Panisi.
Yes. I'm Frank Panisi. I'm from the Southern Tier Independence Center in Binghamton, New York. We work with people with disabilities. I'm here today largely to recommend quick passage of 1058 and 1386. 1058, which would make polling places accessible, we have been trying get such a bill passed for more years than I can count. A lot of people with disabilities have not been full participants in the election process because, number one, they couldn't get into the polling place. Number two, if they could get in, they couldn't use the old lever machines. Now we've got the accessible machines, but there's still too many sites that are inaccessible, so the person who needs to use the machine can't get in to use it. I've been working on this issue for 25 years. I started in my home county of Broome in 1984, a campaign to make all polling places accessible. We did it. We were the first county in the state to do it, but it took 6 years. And what finally pushed it over the edge was in 1990, my county board refused to grant any waivers. Four polling sites were moved very quickly, two were modified. I mean, we're talking a 3-inch step and a 6-inch step. So it wasn't a big deal, but the refusal to grant waivers is what finally did it. The waiver process is what is standing in the way of accessibility throughout the state. I'm one of the lucky ones. I've got incredibly cooperative county boards of elections throughout the years. I talk to my colleagues around the state and I hear their county is 10% accessible or 5% accessible or even 3% accessible. And I've heard of waivers being granted in the 1980s and 90s that are still considered to be viable today, even though they're supposed to be reapplied for every year. So the waiver is a problem. It's been misused, it's been abused over the years as far as accessibility. Someone earlier had stated that a lot of these buildings are supposed to be accessible by state and federal law. That is absolutely true. And I don't think the onus should be on the Board of Elections to make changes to buildings that are required to be accessible. But a lot of polling places are in churches. Churches are exempt from the Americans with Disabilities Act. Many churches are more interested in accessibility, but the fact is they don't have to be by law, and often they can't afford the ramp or the widening of the doors or whatever is needed to be done. My county, Broome, and neighboring Tioga County used HABA funds to make all their sites accessible for the ones that they did for a lot of churches, a lot of buildings that weren't otherwise required or that it would have been an undue burden for. Another thing, county elections commissioners are not well-versed in accessibility standards, nor should they be expected to be. Having worked closely with these people over the years, it's amazing the variety of duties they have, and they don't need one more thing piled on top of them. There are independent living centers throughout the state. There are statewide commissions that have the expertise and access. They should be tapped to provide the expertise, as I've done with my county and several other of my colleagues have. And as far as accessibility, we think of it as benefiting a small number of people with disabilities now. What we don't think about is that all of us will acquire a disability as we age, if we live long enough. Many of our senior citizens are now having problems with vision and mobility impairments. Many of our veterans from the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan are coming back with service-related disabilities. It's not just a small special interest group. It really benefits all of us. And as far as 1386, last year, my county board asked me to help them recruit people with disabilities to serve as election inspectors because they, like everyone else, are having trouble finding enough people. And my agency serves about 2,000 to 3,000 people a year. We sent out invitations. We got not one single response, which really surprised me. But as it turns out, very few people with disabilities were able to endure a 15-hour shift. They just couldn't do it. They were willing to do a 5-hour shift, a 7-hour shift, but 15 hours they couldn't do. So I think this bill would help bring in more potential inspectors by just opening up for more people. And thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Panisi. Yes. Any questions from my colleagues?
Mr. Fagan, Mr. Panisi, you should know that as we go through these hearings throughout the state, we're starting to see, I guess, common problems, whether they be in Albany, Manhattan, you know, or here. And so this is why these hearings are helpful, as we start to address these most common problems. So with the changing dynamics of the voting process, with the increased amount of voters, the issues of accessibility and the issues of new different training for poll workers to handle the different changing climate patterns of our voting population, that's why these hearings are helpful, so we can start to work on these issues. So I thank you again both for your time and testimony.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our next panel, Diane Dwyer, Chair of Onondaga County Committee, and Justin Zarni, Chairman of the 17th Ward, City of Syracuse.
Senator Daba, ready? Senator
Please.
Daba, Senator Griffith, and Senator Valesky, hi. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to speak on these proposed bills. I'm going to only comment, and I will try to be very brief.
Thank you,
Hopefully, and on four of them. The first one is the early voting. You know, I agree with this concept. I think the issue is not long waiting lines. I think it's really giving people the flexibility. And in the proposal, it suggests 1 week. I might suggest instead of 1 week in one place, it would be the weekend before in multiple places. But as has been stated, this certainly does create some problems, and because of the multiple different types of ballots that we have. One of the things that I would say, requiring the vote, and I read this, to be counted within 24 hours, I think is very unrealistic if we're talking about a paper ballot. I know it goes on a little bit here and canvassing, and it's just an unrealistic expectation. But we, I think, should look into that. This next one is 2868A, the additional information on the absentee ballots. And I like to say, as a healthcare professional and nurse, this almost strikes me as a violation of HIPAA. Violations, but I know it truly is not a HIPAA violation. But for the state to require such information that is very personable regarding even their physician in their hospital or where they're going on vacation, it certainly does create some, which is, I think this is material that is foilable, creates some serious concerns. And I would very much urge that this be passed immediately. One of the other things, though, that's not quite mentioned in here is that when we look at absentee ballots, and as several people have suggested maybe using more of that than the early voting, is that we really need to maybe look at the reasons why absentee ballots are disqualified. I think of the coffee rings, the extraneous marks, and I understand that because I've sat in on those sessions when we go over absentee ballots, but I also know my 89-year-old father, who has a permanent absentee ballot, is 89 years old and could easily spill coffee on the ballot. And therefore, it should not really be disqualified, and I know they don't know that. The next one, 1701. I think our election inspectors, you know, they work 1 to 2 days a year. They're very good. They're very competent. And they take their job very responsible. But they are humans, and humans make errors. So if a voter is inadvertently given an affidavit ballot in the wrong voting election districts, then I think that really that ballot should be counted. However, this does create, once again, different problems because it may be the wrong ballot, and only those elections that would pertain to them in their proper election district could be counted, which is actually why I would very much prefer the other. I just lost my place for a second. That I would very much prefer the bill 6991, or I'm not sure which one it is 2443. It seems to be the same. This one would require voters to be directed to the correct polling place on an election district. If the intent of the various proposed legislation is to increase voter turnout and to assure that each vote is counted, we have to come into the 21st century. It is argued that paper copies and of maps and street finders can be very, very voluminous. This is true, but not an acceptable excuse. In today's age of technology, we have computers, Palm Pilots, and other electronic devices. that could be used by the inspectors to be linked directly to the voter registration system to look up the voters and provide them with the accurate information of where to vote. We should at least start to implement this in larger cities. The paper hard copies is doable in many of the towns and villages. In fact, in the town of Camilla, street finders and polling places were at one time provided to the inspectors in order to direct voters to the proper voting place. However, this is not true for all of the towns. To implement this legislation, each polling place, though, I believe, should be required to have what I would call a coordinator, who would solely be responsible for assisting the voters to correct the correct election district. It just does not seem appropriate for you've got inspectors doing multitasks. It may be one person dedicated. I'd like to share one quick thing. In the past election, we had several, we identified several voting places in Onondaga County, and we had some of our volunteers, our quote poll watchers, who were there actually voluntarily coordinating, calling us at headquarters. We were looking up where the election polls were so they could help direct the calls get swamped. So I think it's something that maybe we need to start with a pilot, because it certainly would be a lot of training, but I think it would be extremely beneficial. So I would say, if you are truly sincere about increasing voter participation versus voter suppression, we must have reform in our election laws, and funding for the counties must be provided so that it can be implemented. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Arnold.
Was that quick?
Did
I
get it? Very good.
Mr. Arnold.
Senator, thank you for allowing me to testify today. I've been an activist for voting rights for all my entire adult life. I think I was born into it, and I'm chair of a very active ward here in Syracuse. I'm going to be brief. I do want to touch on most of these bills here, but before I do, I would ask and encourage the Senate to look into ways to help fund these various bills. Passing these amendments to our Constitution will have no effect if the current level of funding for the elections boards across the county or across the state are kept up. If we need to have an investment in our own democracy, which is a very important investment. It will lead to a better participation at all levels of government, and we'll reap benefits from that fruit for generations to come if we can do that. And as the Empire State, I think we can. In the first bill, the Early Voting Act, I'm a father of a 19-year-old freshman who chose to go to the University of South Florida, and much to my chagrin, actually changed her registration down there last year because, in her words, we needed the votes there more than we needed the votes here. And so I had to agree with her. And she participated in the early voting in Florida. And stood in long lines, a couple of hours to do so. I'm definitely in favor of early voting here in New York State. I think there's a way to do it. Again, it must be funded. We must have those funds to do this. Having one location inside a county, just the County Board of Elections, is not enough. We have a very big mall that I'm sure they'll be looking to rent space in. These are places that with our modern technology that we can, you know, link into the voter database, that we can have early voting places throughout the county, especially in federal election years where there's such a high need and want for voting, but it must be funded. If we just put this mandate out there, it will not be realized. However, early voting, you know, although absentee ballot voting, as Mr. Sesniak said, could help with that situation, I think many voters like the tactile sensation of actually going in there and marking a ballot, pushing a button, or clicking a lever. And that is I know I feel proud as a citizen when I go in to vote. And if somebody wants to early vote and be able to want to stand in those lines and do that, I think we should find a way to make that possible. However, coming to the absentee ballot vote, absentee ballots S5028 and S2868, which I believe pretty much go together, it is ridiculous that we, require in this day and age a reason for an absentee ballot. We have single parent families who may not be able to get out of the house to go vote. We have people who work and travel long commutes to their to and from their job and may only get have a few hours throughout the day where they could actually get to the polling place. And if they see long lines when they get there, they're going to pull their car out and go to their the responsibilities of their families. If they know ahead of time that they it would be easier and more beneficial for them to do an absentee ballot, by all means, we should find a way to make that possible. Removing that language from the absentee ballot would allow that. S-1701, although I'm in favor of this in theory, I do have to worry about the practicality of it, especially in odd election years where there are local elections going on. It seems like it may be a little too permissive. On a county-wide level, even in state election years where we have state senate and state assemblies, you're talking about two-thirds of the county where you would go to vote if you were in the wrong place, that your ballot may not be counted for anything but a statewide or countywide race, because you're voting in, the affidavit ballots in the polling places will be different than the affidavit ballot that would be in your true polling place. And so your vote will not be counted in the elections throughout, especially on the local levels. And in an odd election year like this, where we have many city races going on this year, if you're just across, if you just decide to go across the border into DeWitt, those ballots are not going to be available. And in a very busy election day, they may not be able to get to the right place. So I think we need to actually put this one on the voters a little bit. However, this can be resolved by making this maybe a town or city-wide instead of county-wide change. And this will resolve that issue for all but the lowest level of district councilor or towns that have a ward system where they have district town councils. And although there may be instances where some votes are not counted for those races, there will also be most of the, I think the spirit that what we are trying to do here with this will be allowed to count. And I think the benefits of that will far outweigh the problems that are happening. I don't think anybody has any issue with requiring that the polling places be accessible to the disabled. I do think that there is some question of how we do that. I'm not even going to really touch on that too much. However, authorizing the Board of Elections to employ election inspectors to work half-day shifts. From what I understand, you're not requiring half-day shifts, but you're authorizing them to have half-day shifts in some inspection cases. And I believe that will open up the pool of inspectors, and we will get a better quality of inspector as well by opening up that pool. We may have teachers who work in a school that is a polling place who decide after their teaching day is ending at 2 o'clock to work the 2 to 9 shift. This will be a great opportunity to have a higher level of inspector. You can still have inspectors that work all day, so you can have the history of what happened in that polling place throughout the day that can be reported on. But if you're allowing for half day inspectors, I think, you know, and people who are working shift work, we're going to open up that position to people that may serve the public a little bit better and also be fresher throughout the day. 6 a.m. to 9 p.m. is a very long day, and I work at every election day, so I know by 9 p.m. I'm not as responsive to the people calling me on the phone as I was at 6 a.m.
It's actually a much longer day because they get there earlier, and by the time they
that's
wrap
right.
up.
So that's right, and they have to count the ballots at the end. So. You know, lastly, S-2443. I think this is going to be the most expensive of the options. And again, I urge that New York State actually fund this option. Commissioner Ryan brought forth an example of a software system, a handheld software system that could help with this, which is $45,000 in the first year. Again, this seems like a lot of money in these tough economic times, but again, it is an investment in our democracy. And if we are going to try to get our voters to the right polls, a lot of times, if you're just giving them a card and say call and try to find out the information, if the phone line is busy or if they're busy, they're not going to make that call. They're just going to leave and they're not going to come back. Having the information there at the polling place will allow these people to vote quicker and we will get those people to the right polling place, which may just be a couple blocks away, especially if the other provision is not passed for the countywide voting. So, I urge that we adopt that measure, but I also urge we adopt it with funds to back it up.
Mrs. Arney, Ms. Wire, thank you very much for your testimony and your suggestions as well, and I really appreciate the suggestion part as we go forward. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time and testimony. Our next panel, Dr. Wanda Warren Berry, Director of New Yorkers for Verified Voting, and Dr. Gran Reyes. I apologize if I mispronounced the name. Reher, I am so sorry.
Shall I go first? Good morning, Senator Addabbo and Valesky and Griffo. And I'm glad to put a face with the name David Kogelman. I'm Wanda Warren Berry, Director of New Yorkers for Verified Voting. We refer to that as NYVV. We are a nonprofit citizens group which has been advocating for election integrity in New York during the 5 years that the state has faced the challenge of the Help America Vote Act. On our website, NYVV publishes its aim as, quote, to ensure that all eligible citizens can vote and that their votes will be accurately counted. During the years leading up to the county's choices of equipment for HAVA compliance under the leadership of our former director, Bo Lapari, we were recognized as a driving force behind the strong grassroots effort to advocate for a system based on voter-marked paper ballots. That choice now having been made, NYVV's current focus is on encouraging citizen oversight of the implementation of this system through procedures and practices that promote security during the recording and counting of the votes. While we stand ready to oppose and critique any voting systems, procedures, or policies that could violate a citizen's right to vote, our particular emphasis is on technological and procedural accuracy and security. Therefore, I will emphasize these aspects of the bills before you today, and I won't speak to all of the bills. I'll try to shorten this. First, the Early Voting Act. Our position now is that early voting ought not to be adopted until New York has in place careful procedures and arrangements to keep both the machines and ballots secure during an extended period for the casting of ballots. While we support every reasonable effort to encourage more people to vote, our constituents in NYVV at this point disagree with one another about the value of early voting, and I receive arguments on both sides. Therefore, we believe this bill should be tabled until there is more evidence that early voting actually is effective enough in improving voter turnout to make it worth the extra demand for staffing and security. Another reason for delaying action on this issue, we think, is that it seems unwise to institute early voting at the same time that New York is implementing a completely new voting system. So we suggest tabling that. With regard to what's called no excuse absentee voting, many of our constituents support these measures to allow the state to protect the privacy of voters who apply for an absentee ballot. It's true, and another colleague of mine will go into more detail with this later, that the absentee ballot is intimidating to some people and discourages them from voting even when they can't get to the polling place. I do want to point out that absentee ballots sent by mail are inevitably less secure than those cast in the polling place. Therefore, every possible step must be taken to protect both the security and privacy of absentee ballots. I want to skip down then to Bill 1836A, the proposal that would allow election inspectors to work half-day shifts. NYVV supports this proposal, and I like the way the bill is written that calls for at least one inspector from each major party to be there for the whole election day. Most of the inspectors we've talked to support this bill, and many of us are election inspectors. I do want to point out particularly the concerns for security and accuracy that cause us to support this measure. People who are tired are more apt to make mistakes than when they're not so tired. The security procedures for the new equipment that have been described to us will take alertness and attention to detail at every step, especially in opening and closing the polls. Therefore, half-day shifts for at least some workers seem to be indicated so that people are alert and able to do that. I have more concern, and I know there's more controversy about the bill numbered 5112. This is the bill that would require a place on the ballot to indicate that one has intentionally undervoted. With a few members of NYV dissenting from this position, the majority of our board of directors and steering committee believes that New York's law should not require undervote notification in the programming of the scanners. Only overvote notification is required by HAVA. As a matter of fact, so far we don't know of other states that require undervote notification. We should research that, but we haven't found any. We believe the opportunity to correct the ballot for which HAVA calls is provided when you have a paper ballot that can be reviewed in the privacy booth and replaced if the voter asks for a new copy. And that could be done before submission to the scanner. Therefore, we think this change in the ballot is unnecessary and that it will confuse voters. Instead, the undervote notification requirement should be rescinded in New York so that scanners would not be programmed to do undervote notification but only overvote. We urge instead that the Senate develop a bill that would amend Election Law 6209.28 to delete the phrase or undervote. This is the sentence that would be changed. In a paper ballot, I'm quoting now, in a paper-based voting system, the system must indicate to the voter specific contests or ballot issues for which an overvote or undervote is detected. We suggest deleting or undervote. There are several reasons for this change. First, the protection of privacy. Notice that HAVA advises in the section following the description of need to notify of overvotes, advises that, quote, any notification required under this paragraph preserve the privacy of the voter and the confidentiality of the ballot. We have found that automatic notification of an undervote is seen by many as threatening the privacy of their vote, especially in small jurisdictions with a short ballot. It might seem easy for those in the polling place to know when a voter deliberately did not vote in an uncontested race. Reports from states that already have implemented paper ballot scanner systems suggest that voters are confused, even when the scanners warn only of overvotes. And there's a tendency for the poll workers to get involved and for a jeopardization of privacy. We also would point out that automatic notification of undervotes will slow the submissions of ballots to the scanners. We would want to point out that adding the box for the voter to indicate intentional undervoting, as in this proposed bill, is an unnecessary complication of the process of learning the new voting system, since notification of undervotes was not required on the lever machines. I want to then point out that if the election law requiring notification of undervotes is not amended, some kind of arrangement needs to be made to overwrite undervote notification. But I think having the box to indicate intentional undervoting at the top of the ballot is not as good a solution as having that box at the bottom of the ballot. In sum, we believe that if voters are carefully educated about the ballot and encouraged to review it in the privacy booth, undervote notification is unnecessary on the scanners, and that requirement should be rescinded. However, we realize that there may need to continue to be undervote notification on the ballot marking devices. I'm going to just mention one thing that came up in my dialogue with members of my board in the last couple of days, and I want to make sure it's known that this recommendation doesn't grow out of any experience with election commissioners in this room, because I think they don't need the training I'm going to suggest. But I do hear from people around the state who do not have confidence in us moving forward with this new system and confidence in the way their vote will be counted, because they do not have confidence in the professional training of their election commissioners. As an educator, I want to encourage development of legislation that would require certification of election commissioners. Modern elections and their technologies are complex and ought no longer to be managed by persons who lack specific training for their positions. While many commissioners conscientiously attend workshops over the years and are qualified by years of experience, even they would be benefited by a process that would recognize that they are professionals, that their work requires training and expertise. The day is past when we can assume that anyone nominated by a county political committee is able to run elections. Training schools might be provided by the state on the model of those offered for persons elected as town clerks and justices. I also suggest that certifying programs could be developed in regional community colleges. And I've suggested some of the courses that might be there, like computer skills, mathematics, and so forth, ethics for election administrators. While many of our commissioners could be certified without further training, it is time to make sure all of our elections are in the hands of qualified persons with professional training. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Barry. Dr. Ray.
Thank you, Senator Addabbo, Senator Valesky, Senator Grippo, for the opportunity to testify today. I don't have copies of my testimony ready to share, but I'll polish what I'm about to say and send that to Bai very quickly. We're limited to 3 minutes, and as you might gather, 3 minutes to an academic is like a nanosecond. So I'll get right to my conclusion. The answer is yes. That is, I'm generally in favor of these proposals as a group, but I also have a broader lingering reservation. Regarding the yes, I think anything that opens up the voting process further, that makes it more inclusive and easier to vote, is likely to have a positive effect on voting levels and simply provides people greater opportunities to vote. So from a small D Democratic perspective, these seem to be good ideas. And as I'm sure you know, New York is one of the more restrictive states when it comes to voting and participation rules, so you could argue that the changes are even more needed here. Having said that, I'd also note, though, that none of these is going to lead to a revolution in higher voting turnout, and I'm sure you know that as well. One thing I would note in that regard, though, is the research from my political science colleagues recently suggests that a particularly effective difference maker for people voting is not rules or technological changes, but rather in-person appeals to vote, the power of peers working in real space and real time. And that finding actually ties in with my broader reservation, which I'll get to in just a second. The one proposal here that I find particularly intriguing is the last one on the list. It's gotten a lot of attention so far, allowing a voter to state the intentionality of undervoting. If I understand that proposal correctly, you could see it as a very weak version of a none-of-the-above option, which exists right now only in Nevada in the United States, and even there it's a non-binding result. I actually think none-of-the-above would be a good idea in New York, and this slight nod toward it is a good thing, I think. But here's the big reservation I have. John Madden used to like to say that NFL football needed more bunting. Not the baseball kind of bunting, but the red, white, and blue kind that you hang from your window or the skybox of a stadium. I think our voting also needs more bunting. And what I mean by that is that our day of voting needs to be wrapped in a civic pageant that makes it more of a shared community event, a shared state event, even a shared national event, and that helps to invest it in a greater civic meaning. And so our voting days, I think, need to be more genuine holidays. They need to be days of reflection, days of deliberation, conversation, and civic celebration. In order to do that, the day itself has to maintain its importance. And the act of voting needs to be something that we do together at one time. And there needs to be, I think, an actual moment of decision. And viewed from that perspective, some of these proposals and others that have recently been instituted in other states to make voting easier arguably dilute that to some degree. And I'm referring here particularly to the Early Voting Act and the removal of restrictions on absentee voting. Now, other proposals here, of course, strengthen the civic value that I'm describing, the provisions for the disabled, the requirement to direct voters who are in the wrong place to the right place. But from this perspective of creating a civic community event, I think you'd want to focus on making voting on the day easier, but also to preserve that day's importance. So things like requiring employers to give time off for voting, or holding our elections on Sunday, or having more polling places all make sense from that perspective. But again, from this standpoint, with a couple of the proposals that are under consideration here, what we may be doing is chasing a slightly higher turnout, which is a valuable goal, at the expense of changing something important about the civic nature of the very enterprise itself. But having said all that, then I awake from my ancient Greek city-state dream and conclude on balance that the additional ease of voting, not only on the day, but before that day, is probably a desired thing. So to go back to my conclusion, the answer is yes.
Dr. Ray, thank you very much. Any questions from my colleagues?
Senator Griffin. Professor, I don't think you should shriek away from the Greek dream. It would probably be something that is a great encouraging aspect to try to get a national debate on the date itself. I mean, many other countries use weekends, and we tend to continue to look at that Tuesday. So I think that's a very valuable subject for consideration and discussion and advocacy. The question I would have is relative to when you talk about some of these procedures, while they're intended to make it easier, could it also be problematic in the sense that in the last week of an election, things change? And if you have early voting, something dramatically may happen where somebody may have thought, gee, I wish I had that opportunity to tap my vote again. Is that a problem, do you see?
Well, that's always the issue and the trade-off that you're making with early voting. The research tends to indicate that most elections, most of the time, by the time you get to that point, most voters' preferences are pretty well locked in for the general election, at least for the big top of the ticket races. I mean, there always is movement at the end, and certainly we've seen that if we go back last 16 years or so. You can see evidence of people making up ground at the last second. But that is the risk. I think the theme that I would emphasize here today, though, is going back to what you started with, to the degree that we want to make this a meaningful thing, and that's really what our European counterparts do a better job of than we do. Having the elections on Sunday is one thing. There are other things that they do as well. You've got to keep that day being very, very important and have it be something that we do together.
Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you very much, Senator Griffo. There being no other questions, I want to thank this panel very much for their time today. Thank you very much. Our next panel, Reginald O'Neill, Citizens for Better New York, and Nina Cohen, a professor at Syracuse University College of Law. For being here today. Please state your name for the record and give your testimony.
Thank you, Senator, Chair, and Senators for allowing me to be here today. My name is Nina Cohn. I'm an associate professor at Syracuse University College of Law, where my research focuses on the civil rights of older adults and where I've had the opportunity to study and write about access to voting by persons with disabilities and senior citizens. My testimony today will focus on Senate Bill 1058A. 1058A represents an improvement over current law and will help bring our state into compliance with federal law instead of simply stating that there must be an accessible entrance but allowing a waiver. 1058A requires all polling places to be accessible to citizens with disabilities and comply with the accessibility guidelines of the Americans with Disabilities Act. While I support this bill, I believe it does not go far enough. Specifically, I'm concerned that it will fail to make voting accessible to all citizens with disabilities for two primary reasons. First, the bill focuses on access to polling places and not on access to voting itself. But it's not enough to be able to get in the door of the polling place. To successfully vote, the voter must be able to access the ballot, comprehend the ballot, and register voting preferences. Accordingly, elections are only truly accessible when voting equipment is accessible, election staff understand and can use that equipment, and appropriate assistance is available to those who need it. The ADA guidelines with which this bill would require compliance don't address these issues. They provide detailed guidance as to the design of other facilities, mini golf courses, piers, but they say nothing about polling places, voting equipment, or election procedures. Moreover, they generally only apply to the design or construction of new facilities or the alteration of existing ones. I would therefore encourage this committee to amend the bill to cover voting equipment and procedures as well as polling places. The first sentence of a revised bill might read something like replacing the words each polling place with all polling places, voting equipment, and procedures. Okay. Second, the bill focuses only on the physical accessibility of voting. And I would urge this committee to address, either in this bill or in future legislation, the cognitive accessibility of voting. Physical disabilities are only one form of disability that can prevent citizens from being able to exercise their right to vote. Cognitive disabilities, even those as seemingly minor as short-term memory loss or mild confusion, can really create formidable barriers to voting, and that's true even where those disabilities don't rise to the level that they undermine the capacity to make informed voting choices. So a number of reforms are possible that could reduce the extent to which cognitive disability prevents would-be voters from exercising their fundamental right to vote. A key reform in this state would be to change a very outdated election law, New York Election Law 5.1066, that in clear opposition to our limited guardianship scheme denies the right to vote to anyone adjudicated incompetent, regardless of whether they've been adjudicated incompetent to vote or not. Other reforms could focus on polling place conditions such as low lighting and distracting noises that increase the cognitive demands of voting and thus may effectively make voting impossible for certain citizens. Other reforms could focus on ballot design, eliminating unduly complex and confusing ballots. Finally, actually making the absentee balloting process less complex, as two of the bills being considered here today would do, could also help make voting more cognitively accessible to persons with disabilities. In considering these forms, the committee might find informative the American Bar Association's new recommendations regarding voting by persons with mental and cognitive disabilities. In conclusion, I think 1058A is a step in the right direction, but it really does fall short of making voting accessible. Attention needs to be paid to the physical and cognitive barriers to voting that remain even once someone has crossed the threshold into the polling place. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you. Professor Cohen. Thank you. Mr. Neal.
Good morning, Senator Addabbo, Senator Griffin, and Senator Valesky. Thank you for the opportunity to testify here this morning. My name is Reginald Neal. I live at 6032 County Road 41 in Farmington. I've been a resident of New York State my entire life. I am a member of Citizens for a Better New York, a nonpartisan group working for reform of state government. As you know, CFBNY is currently addressing several reform issues. Our members have testified at several Senate hearings across the state. However, my testimony today reflects my personal views, which are not necessarily those of my organization. I want to thank you and Senator Smith for providing this forum. I certainly hope that the state Senate is setting an enduring precedent with these statewide hearings. Let us hope that this demonstrates a new commitment to making real-world connections with citizens and to documenting their input on important issues. The Senate's new web link that encourages online public comments on pending legislation is also a valuable new tool. Rather than comment in detail on the bills that were listed for discussion today, I'd just like to make some brief comments. In general, I support legislation that improves voter access or process, and there are additional comments in my written testimony. Much of the discussion to date has been about the effects of legislation on the general election, but primary elections are a critical component of needed reforms to state government. Challengers who run in primaries are often individuals who are motivated to make changes and to implement reforms. Yet, both major political parties have historically used primaries as a tool to block challengers and to reduce the choices available to voters. We must make sure that primary elections are fair and that they preserve the widest possible range of electoral choices for citizens. I support changes to election law, like those proposed by Senate Bill 355, 1366, and Assembly Bill 4161 and 2651, which affect petition requirements. There are two other issues which may at first seem peripheral to today's discussion, but which, in my opinion, are central to the idea of fair elections. First, even if all the election law problems which have been discussed before this committee were solved, voters are still being deprived of fair representation because the boundaries of legislative districts are distorted for political advantage. I hope you and your committee will support the creation of a truly independent commission with the power to draw legislative district lines. Second, fair elections are impossible without campaign finance reform. As long as wealthy individuals or those supported by special interests or backed by the political establishment are the only ones who can afford to run an effective election campaign, our state legislature will continue to be the most dysfunctional in the nation. I am glad to see that you have scheduled future hearings dedicated to campaign finance reform. Finally, one can't help but be struck that in testimony before this committee and also before the Temporary Committee on Rules of Administration, individuals and organizations alike have repeatedly pointed to the Brennan Center's recommendations. Citizens and good government groups all across the state largely agree on the kinds of changes that need to be made. There is never a shortage of good ideas. The real deficit has been leadership. Leadership develops the political consensus for implementing solutions. I hope that you, your committee, and the Senate as a whole will maintain your momentum. You have my support and encouragement. Please do not fail to take maximum advantage of your new tools. Your goal must be real changes in state government, changes that can restore New York State to its historic position as a world leader in jobs, education, finance, and health care. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Mr. Neal. Any questions for my colleague? I want to thank both of you for your testimony. I do have one real quick question for Professor Cohen. You said the American Bar Association, they have a report?
Yes, and I'd be happy to provide that to your staff.
And please, that would be helpful. Thank you very much, both of you. I appreciate your time here today. Our next panel, Charles Pierce L., National Action Network, and Lenore Rapalski, Director of Advocacy for Syracuse League of Women. Syracuse League of Women Voters, sorry. Mr. Pearsall, you can certainly start.
First of all, I want to thank you, Senators, for coming here to Syracuse, New York, and opening up this process. It's been way overdue.
Thank you.
Senator Bottom, Senator Dave McClaskey, my senator, and Joseph, Senator Joseph Griffel, and counselor and young lady. And thank you for coming here to Syracuse to hear our complaints and hear our concerns.
Thank you.
On behalf of the Alliance Network, I'm playing three hats here, but first of all, Senator, I'd like to tell you something that very disturbing, and you know, you can take it either way. You brought some bad weather here, because we had good weather up until you came here late.
So, I'll try and take it back with me. How's that?
Thank you.
Fair enough.
Appreciate that. Fair enough. Secondly, on behalf of the Alliance Network, my president, Walt Dixie, we agree with everything that you have set down on here. We agree with everything. He informed me to make sure that I emphasize that the Alliance Network is in agreement in everything that you have here. On my other hat, I'm also the chairperson of the Southside Homeowners Association, and we too agree with this here on behalf of the Homeowners Association. And as an advocate, a community advocate, I heard a lot of things here today, and a lot of things were good, and a lot of things we were not helping you guys with your solutions. And I like to point out some solutions that I think is way overdue for a person that history predicts that we have been disenfranchised for a long time in this here country, and I'm a product of that, and of my ancestors that have died to give us this right to vote in this country, this great country of ours. There's a lot of things that need to be said that was not said, and the solution is we've asked a lot of times of our people and our senators and our elected officials for money to pay, but we have a lot of times that we can volunteer, and we don't capitalize on that. And for the senator and for this committee, I would also suggest that we started using our children, because this country is based on our children's future. And in my particular district that I can speak on, which is the largest district in the city of Syracuse, the fourth district, our voting is terrible, and our young people do not participate only because of a lack of education. And our commissioners in this community does not set up enough education, not only the commissioners, but organizations like NAACP, the churches, youth organizations, schools. We don't set up enough programs to teach our children to volunteer for some of these things that you guys are putting in place for us. You know, it's just like a farmer. Farmer has a whole lot of good seeds. Some of those seeds are going to flourish and some are not, and you got to weed them. And we don't do a good job of weeding and educating our children as a collective amount of people in our district. And sure, there should be some stifling somewhere along the line to help educate these children, especially children of my complexion and of the African-American community. And I can only speak of Syracuse, even though I know it happens across this whole United States. And I would like for this committee, not only for this particular thing, and for my Senator Dave Velasquez, to help implement some of these changes that need to take place. Because in our election, in our fourth district election, we have over 7,000 people in that district. Only 1,200 turns out. And we have a deciding factor of maybe 500 people deciding who our elected officials are in the city of Syracuse in the fourth district. And that's ludicrous. That is terrible. And I think the main point that we have to start using and showing our young people how to volunteer, and that'll take up some slack of the pay that normally people are always asking for pay. So with the volunteerism and maybe some type of stifling and educational purposes, I think that would very help you guys, help us, and help our country grow even with this pilot. Because this is a pilot, and without you guys doing this, we never would have had this in the first place. So I want to thank you and commend you guys for a job well done. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Pearsall. Thank you. Ms. Lepowski.
Yes. I have a feeling that you may have heard this testimony before.
In Albany, yes. But yes. Please.
I'm Lenore Lepowski.
If you could summarize, that'd be... Yeah,
yes, I will.
I appreciate that.
I will. I fully intended to. My name is Lenore Lepowski, and I'm Director of Advocacy and Local Issues for the Syracuse Metro League of Women Voters. The testimony I was going to read today has already been read for the purposes of the audience behind me, has already been read in Albany to, I believe, two of you at least. I don't know, Senator Valesky, if you were there, but you can have a copy of it. So.
I have it already.
All right. Pretty much the items that our election specialist, that would be Amy Lowe for the New York State League of Women Voters, I have a collection of the bills, and also whether we agreed with them or not. Would you like me to read that, not for your purposes, but more for the people?
Again, if you could summarize that portion,
sure.
I appreciate it.
Senate Bill 3250, that is your bill, Senator Addabbo, enacting the Early Voting Act. The League has no position on the early voting per se, because there has not been opportunity to study the effects. The second, S5028 and S2868-A, that's you, Senator Addabbo, both expand absentee voting by removing unnecessary documentation requirements on the application for an absentee ballot. The League strongly supports both of these measures, and both the New York State Election Commissioners Association and the New York State Board of Elections also support the measures. Senate Bill 1701, DeLand, the counting of affidavit ballots. The League has no position on the bill. Senate Bill 1058-8, Addabbo, requiring that all polling places be accessible to physically disabled voters. The League supports the bill, which will amend the New York State election law to conform to federal accessibility standards. S1836-A, Klein, permits election inspectors to work half-day shifts. The League supports this measure, which potentially may increase the number of citizens who apply to work as poll inspectors and draw younger individuals into the process. S2443, Stewart-Cousins, the League has no position on this bill. Finally, S5112, Foley, in relation to the form of the paper ballot. This bill would add a new subdivision to the election law stating that ballots must provide an area to be filled in by a voter that would notify the voting system that the voter intended to undervote deliberately, so the optical scanner would not produce an error message which would reject the ballot. And that's it. Thank you very much.
Ms. Polsky, thank you very much. I appreciate your time, sir. Thank you so much, Ms. Pearsall. Our next panel, Robert Spitzer, Chair of the Political Science Department for SUNY Cortland, and Richard Kendrick, Civic Engagement Director for SUNY Cortland. Good afternoon, gentlemen.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the opportunity to testify. I am Robert Spitzer, Chair of the Political Science Department at SUNY Cortland. I believe all of the proposals under consideration merit speedy passage by the State Senate. But I wish to use my limited time to speak primarily about the so-called no-excuse early voting. As you know, 32 states allow for early voting. In the 2000 presidential elections, 14% of all votes cast nationwide were cast before Election Day. That would include paper voting and in-person voting, early voting. In 2004, nationwide, 22% of all votes cast were early votes. And last year, 2008, it was a third of all votes cast. Early voting is no longer an experiment. It's instead an integral feature of the voting process across the country. And it has, I think, three obvious benefits without really any measurable drawbacks. And I say that understanding that there are financial startup costs and there are knowledge costs as well. First, it relieves one-day Election Day pressures on election officials and voters by spreading out the voting process. Second, it makes voting more convenient. Third, the measure before the state Senate lets early voting occur at local Board of Election offices, where early voting can, in effect, serve as a testing ground for equipment and procedures before actual Election Day arrives. And as to my colleague Grant Reher's point about Election Day needing more bunting, I certainly agree, but I think he misses the point about early voting. Early voting magnifies the bunting effect because people actually voting will vote and will talk about voting, and it's in-person conversations and the buzz of the election process before Election Day that will add bunting to our electoral process, absent moving our Election Day to a Saturday or a Sunday. Now, last fall, I witnessed early voting in Delaware County, Indiana, on the Saturday before Election Day. It was November 1st. At the county seat of Muncie, I saw nearly 300 people standing in line waiting to vote at the county clerk's office. According to the county employee who escorted me, employees were willing to work on a Saturday not only to relieve Election Day pressures, but to give people the chance to vote on a weekend. And indeed, America is virtually the only democratic nation that does not hold its elections on the weekend. Support for early voting in Indiana, I should say, is bipartisan. And finally, let me say one thing about early voting and politics. Some have argued that Barack Obama and the Democratic Party were advantaged by early voting in last year's elections, but that's not exactly correct. Obama's campaign did adapt its political strategy to early voting trends, but this reflected two important traits. The first is that Obama's campaign was strategically more advanced than was that of his opponent, just as in 2004, George W. Bush's campaign was strategically more advanced than that of his opponent. And secondly, Obama had far more money to spend on early voting mobilization efforts. The Republicans would have spent it had they had it. Early voting, as well as no excuse absentee voting, is neither Democratic nor Republican. It is instead pro-democracy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Spitzer. Thank you.
Senators, thank you very much for the opportunity to be here today. My name is Richard Kendrick. I'm the director of the Institute for Civic Engagement at SUNY Cortland and a colleague of Bob's. And I'm here to comment specifically on four provisions that I think will enhance student participation in the electoral process. As the director for the Institute for Civic Engagement on our campus, that has been one area of focus for us, is getting students registered to vote, informed to vote, and then to the polls to vote on Election Day. And I have seen a number of obstacles to that process that I think some of these provisions will do a lot to rectify. I am particularly supporting S-1701 that will require that affidavit ballots be counted if they are cast in the right county, but not necessarily the correct polling place. S-3250 that will amend the election law to enact early voting, because I think that will allow those students who would like to vote in their hometowns more accessibility to that opportunity. S-5028 that will allow absentee voting by qualified voters for any reason and without explanation, particularly if it would be possible for students to actually request the ballot on the voter registration form. Right now, they request an application for an absentee ballot. Many students don't understand that that's all they're going to get is the application. They think having checked that, they'll get the ballot in the mail. and they don't understand the process fully. I think if they have the opportunity to receive a ballot off of something that they can mark on the registration form, that would be very advantageous. And then S6991, that requires poll clerks and election workers to provide maps of polling places and assistance to find one's correct polling place, would also be very advantageous for those students who are properly registered but just happen to show up at the wrong site, as they sometimes do. I would reiterate some of the comments made by others earlier that it seems to me to be important that this be automated. Your voter registration and your polling place is now available online. It's amazing to me that we don't have laptops at the polling places with internet access that we can look that up right away and send somebody to the right location. And I hope that that can be something that we can work toward. Provision 1386A that would shorten the days, or the shifts rather, that poll workers would be required to work, I think would be very helpful for increasing student participation as poll workers. We've had a program at Cortland for several years funded initially by the U.S. Election Assistance Commission to train students as poll workers. The response has been excellent. I think this would increase the likelihood that students would participate as poll workers if they didn't have to work the extensive shifts that are currently required. So in short, I want to indicate my support for these provisions. As you may know, the state of New York unfortunately ranks 40th in the nation in the percentage of young people ages 18 to 29 who voted in the 2008 election. I think we can do much better, and I think these provisions will help. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Mr. Kendrick. We do have a question from Senator Griffo.
And Dr. Spitzer, when you look at Dr. Reher and when you were talking about, I find that an interesting concept. Now, he talks about a communal experience, but you talk about generating interest as you lead up to that experience. But isn't that, if you truly want a communal experience, leading up to it could dilute that on that day, would it?
Not to my way of thinking, because the election process is a season, and it's the acceleration through the season that causes people to focus greater attention on the fact that an election is coming up.
Doesn't that already exist in the campaigns?
Well, that's campaigns have that very effect, and more voters become aware that an election is occurring as you approach election day. But the advantage to early voting as a way of accelerating interest is that it happens not through television, although there would be media information, but it happens through in-person contact. It's people going to vote early, a week early, let's say, who then talk to their family members, to their neighbors, their friends, to their coworkers. Hey, I voted yesterday, and it's that direct, as Professor Reher pointed out, it's person-to-person contact that's the most powerful, that has the most powerful impact on the attitudes of others, and the political attitudes of others, and the political awareness of others. And it's precisely because early voting involves feet going to the polls that there's every good reason to believe that it would accelerate interest in the final couple weeks leading up to Election Day.
Could that be accomplished if we were looking at the no-excuse absentee balloting, which would allow people to still cast that ballot earlier, but also then to continue to ensure that people go to the polls on Election Day to try to create that environment that Dr. Reher discussed?
It could, except for one thing, which is absentee voting is a private act, in-person voting is a public act. And I think that distinction would give a little more weight to the beneficial public consequences of allowing in-person early voting, although I certainly agree that loosening extraneous restrictions regarding absentee voting would be beneficial as well.
Thanks.
Thank you, Senator Griffo. Senator Valesky.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Professor Spitzer, thank you for your testimony.
Thank you.
Oh, we have a question.
I'm sorry.
Question. Maybe it's a comment. In regard to early voting, I noticed your experience certainly in Indiana, and often the experience that we read about and hear about in regard to other states often centers around a presidential election. Obviously, that only happens once every 4 years, and I can't imagine a system where we would have bifurcated laws, one for presidential election years and one in the intervening 3 years, I would be interested in any data that you may have in regard to the experience with early voting in other states in non-presidential years, and particularly what that has, how that has affected turnout, if it has at all. I know we always tend to focus on presidential elections, but yeah. That's...
There should be available data on congressional midterm election year turnout rates, and I will pursue that and get back to your office.
Thank you.
Mr. Spitz, Ms. Kendrick, thank you so much again for being here and for your efforts in the SUNY system. I appreciate that as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you for that.
I want to thank Senator Griffo, a member of the Elections Committee, for being here today. Thank you, Senator Griffo. And our last panel, panel two, Mike Atkins, Executive Director for Concerned Citizens Action Program, and Carolyn Todd, New York for Verified Voting.
I have one other gentleman that's going to be with us. This is Bishop Malafi.
Okay, so would you want Ms. Todd to speak first, and then I'll call you up as the last panel. How's that?
Excellent.
Fair enough.
Well, he's from South Africa, so this system is kind of new to him.
Okay.
So if he could just sit right here and...
Is he going to give testimony or no?
Yes, he's just going to give testimony. Yes.
Okay. Ms. Todd, why don't you sit up front here, and then those two gentlemen will be the last panel.
Senators Addabbo and Valesky, good morning. My name is Carolyn Todd. I reside in Hamilton, New York. I'm an election inspector in Madison County, and I'm also a member of New Yorkers for Verified Voting, and I'm very interested in the integrity of elections. I would like to speak today in favor of bills S5028 and 2868-A as they relate to the use of absentee ballots. I would like to present three reasons for supporting these bills. First, the onus is on the voter to state the exact nature of one's absence on election day, but the authority to accept the application rests with the County Board of Elections. Will the voter be out of town due to business obligations? Will a last-minute business trip arise? Will an illness of a senior citizen cause the voter to be housebound on election day? If a business trip or an illness should occur after the 7-day deadline required to postmark the application prior to the election, then the voter is confronted with a problem. The application needs to be hand-delivered to the County Board of Elections at great expense if Federal Express or overnight mail is used. Personally, driving the application to the Board of Elections appears to be an option. In the case of voters who reside in a rural county, such as my own county of Madison, a 34-mile round-trip drive must be made to deliver the application. These last-minute crises can be avoided if voters are permitted to choose a no-excuse absentee ballot. Second, the voter needs to divulge one's location on election day and dates of one's absence. Why is this necessary? Are the rights of voters protected when they are asked to document the place where they expect to be on election day? Who will be responsible for protecting this sort of private information, information that reveals when one's home will be vacant and for the periods of time involved? Third, the quality of time required by candidates and their attorneys and the time required by paid election officials at the local and state levels, challenging and defending these absentee ballots, results in a very costly procedure. Government resources need to be used to serve people with real problems, not spent arguing the technicalities of every absentee ballot in an election. Challenging the absentee ballot of Senator Kirsten Gillibrand in the Congressional District 20 special election this spring does not further the cause of election trustworthiness and accuracy. In conclusion, shrinking budgets and common sense on both the public and private side of the election equation demand that reason prevail. No excuse absentee ballots need to be made legal in New York State. And if I could just make one other comment about one of the other pieces of legislation, which is S2443, pertaining to the assistance of voters when they arrive at the wrong polling place. And I've heard a couple of comments made this morning about sort of beefing up the polling place with more equipment, laptops, it sounds like instantaneous map production, GPS equipment is going to be required. and really sort of institutionalizing a real heavy-duty polling place. I would suggest that a system we have in Madison County is wonderful. We just call the Board of Elections and ask, here's the voter, where should she vote? I know that having cell phones, asking election inspectors to have cell phones is a concern. And so I would suggest for a $10 track phone or a $20 track phone provided to each polling place, the communication is then allowed and encouraged from the poll site to the Board of Elections, and with one or two phone calls, the voter can be assisted and directions can be given. And I would say that trying to get election inspectors to utilize laptops and maps and directions on a laptop is just too much. So that's my thought on that one.
Thank you, Ms. Todd. Mr. Atkins.
Thank you, Senator Addabbo, and to our great senator here in Central New York. My name is Mike Atkins. I'm a former city councilman with the city of Syracuse and also a former city chair in the city of Syracuse. And as you heard earlier, a gentleman spoke about the 4th District. That's the district that at one time I represented, which when he spoke of the numbers of individuals that are not truly represented in there as far as the voting process, that has always been a challenge for that district. I'm here today. Well, I'd like to thank you, first of all, for this panel discussion, because this is a very important issue. And I'd also like to thank Senator Malcolm Smith for hosting these types of panels throughout New York State. But when you talk about the voting participation, when you look at the democracy of our country and the importance of people engaging, it's crucial. Today, I have a visitor that's here with me from South Africa, Bishop Philip Molefe, and he is one of the pioneers that was with Nelson Mandela in South Africa during their apartheid. And I thought it was very fitting for him to come today to see democracy at work here in the United States and right here in our great state of New York and in the city of Syracuse. And I had wanted him to just share with you something that he has witnessed, and just recently through the election of the new president, Joseph Zuma, and the lines of people that stood in line over 5 hours that have walked miles just to engage in a voting process. We talk about access to polls. These individuals walked miles and stood in line in 110 degrees of heat to participate. And I think the key is, how do we begin to get all citizens to truly understand the passion and the importance of voting and for their rights? So I yield my time, and I would just like the bishop, just for a few minutes.
Good afternoon to all the senators here today. I thank Mike for inviting me for this special and interesting occasion. Voting is my interest in South Africa. And here I think I have a cutting here which I've brought along with to show the importance of voting in South Africa. In South Africa, voting is a priority for all the citizens of South Africa. We wake up early hours, even before sunrise, to go to the polls to cast our votes. And this morning, I think it is my pleasure to be in a gathering like this. I didn't know that I'll have an opportunity of sharing my interest when it comes to voting. But I think the cutting that I have here will say it all. Can I hand it over?
Sure, please. Stay right there. We'll have somebody do that for you.
Thank you.
Again, Senator.
Thank you. Thank you.
I'd like to thank you for giving us this opportunity, and especially for allowing the bishop to say a few words on behalf of South Africa.
Well, Mr. Atkins, I am pleased that the bishop is here and that basically he is part of the last panel to highlight the importance of our democracy, not only throughout the state, but throughout the country. So it is fitting, Bishop Halefi, that you are here, and thank you very much for being here. And again, capping off what is, to me, a very constructive and productive hearing. So thank you very much. And Mr. Atkins, you brought up the Fourth Ward, and we heard from Mr. Pierce L. earlier about the numbers, unfortunately, but the need to motivate our younger voters, which I think is very important. And we heard from, I believe it was Dr. Reher earlier, about the need for civic involvement. That's a great theme that we need to promote in our election system, the need to encourage not only young voters, but the voter population in general, to instill upon them the great need to vote and the basic patriotism that is involved in voting. And I think this is something that the Elections Committee wants to look into deeper. So I appreciate your testimony as well. And, Bishop, I wish you a safe trip back to South Africa. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, I thank you all for being a participant of this very constructive hearing as we go forward, not only improving and expanding the voting process from registration to voter participation, but protecting the checks and balances that are there, protecting the integrity and the accuracy of our voting system. We don't want to dilute that in any way, so we need to obviously protect that and in the same way try and promote the increased voter participation. I want all to know the upcoming hearings that the Election Committee is having on May 28th and on June 3rd. May 28th will be in Rochester. On June 3rd will be in Albany. The topic there will be campaign finance reform. And in September, a specific date to be determined, we will be talking about Board of Elections oversight. And in November, we will be talking about elections oversight in general. Again, the purpose of these hearings is to open up the process, to be more transparent, to be more inclusive of the people who this affects on a pretty much a daily basis. So we appreciate your participation here today, and I will take the bad weather back home with me, so don't worry. To the good people of Syracuse, thanks for allowing us to be here today, and thank you very much, everybody. Have a great day.
Thank you.
Senator Valesky, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hi, Lenore.